Unlike the previous match we saw from Joe, where Torkoal had to kind of come in and out and in and out to deal with weather wars against the Bascu Legion on the other side, in this case, there is no opposing weather. So once the Torkoal hits the field once, it is sun for the next 5 turns for Joe to take advantage of. That makes it a little bit easier to do something like position Jump Puff next to Typhlosion in the summon sun and have both of them unlocked.
There's so many levels of comfort for Joe here on his Portland Regional Championship team. He had the Chlorophyll Jump Puff. He had the eject button overheat Torkoal. He had Terra Flying King Gambit as well, so he was able to avoid his team's earthquake attacks there. The big difference this time around is this Hisuian Typhlosion.
It can put out so much damage so quickly. We've seen the Terra Fire Eruption in Sun, how much it does. It means that even a Pokemon like Garchomp that resists it is still threatened with quite a bit of damage coming in. If you let a little bit too much chip come through, or you have a bit of extra damage like the Sucker Punch or Leaf Storm, then the Garchomp will go down. And if those things that can take eruptions like Incineroar and Garchomp start to get chipped away, that opens things up. But Joe's team is also flexible enough to not just focus on that, which can throw a game plan off to the other side. If you instead end up with a very King Gambit and Garchomp focused strategy, then maybe the answers for Andrew are different. But in terms of Andrew's offense, we've seen the Golden Go for the last 2 rounds, and it's probably gonna be about the Golden Go again.
And Andrew, as we have mentioned throughout the stream, has a very balanced team composition. That's Sneasler, the number one used Pokemon in both day 1 and day 2 here in Louisville. You look at the rest of the team, I believe Andrew doesn't have a Pokemon that is lower than 7th or 7th or so in the usage chart, so he's truly using the most prevalent and, you know, strongest Pokemon you can bring to tournament in Regulation 8.
Yeah, the Justin Tang recipe for team building put to work. And then what leads to a pretty unique mix, because it's Porygon 2 with all these other Pokemon. And this could be a matchup where Tailwind is useful, despite otherwise pretty quick-looking team for Andrew's side. There's a lot of fast Pokemon on Joe's side. If you can get some advantage against things like Typhlosion and Jumpluff and Garchomp, then maybe it's the Trick Room that you need. But all of that's going to come down to what Pokemon Joe brings, because if it's the, you know, Torkoal and King Gambit and Dragonite that you're dealing with instead, then the Trick Room is a lot less valuable.
Joe Garte, 2-time regional champion, both of those in the city of Portland. This would be the first time outside of Portland he'd be a regional champion. Andrew Zhang looking for his first ever regional championship. Andrew at the top of your screen, Porygon 2 and Sneasler is the lead. Joe Garte on the bottom with his Suncor, Torkoal, and Jumpluff.
No surprise to see the Suncor out immediately without worrying about weather disruption. It's pretty easy to lead these two, try to get Torkoal off the field to Typhlosion or some other sweeper in the future. This is a more interesting combination from Andrew, though. It's the Porygon and the Sneasler at the same time, trying to kind of measure what kind of approach Joe takes to the game and be able to respond kind of on either side of the speeds.
Yeah, it's such a crucial turn. You know that Joe likes to play fast. You saw his set against Riley, one of the best players in North America, and those games were over relatively quickly. He's very decisive as a player oftentimes. We have the benefit of seeing his perspective a lot, and sometimes he just locks moves in 2 or 3 seconds. He knows what to do.
He is quick about it when he's had a turn to think. And now both players locked in. Terastallization coming out. It is Jumpluff going dark type.
There is that Jumpluff to turn into a dark type here in this spot. On this first turn of game 1, Joe has already locked in his Terastallization. It's the Sleep Powder, 75% accuracy, and it lands into the Porygon 2. That means Porygon 2 has to stay asleep, at least his first mandatory turn. But he calls the Terra Dark into what was a flying type, and the close combat hits the one-hit KO into Jumpluff.
Such a strong turn. Joe hoping to get away from a super effective Dyreclaw, instead walks right into a super effective close combat, and Jumpluff, a key part of this team, goes down on turn 1 with just the Sleep Powder.
Porygon 2 taking that turn of sleep, so can he get more value out of this Torkoal? Overheat in the sun will bring Sneasler down to its focus sash. Now you're not too worried as Torkoal for the special attack drop because of his held item, the patented eject button Torkoal that Joe has made famous throughout the years here in Scarlet and Violet. It will swap itself out, so now Joe can get 2 other Pokemon onto the field for free without taking damage.
No surprise to see the Typhlosion come back in to try to take advantage of this sun, but with Jumpluff already down, less clear how you deal with the Sneasler on adjacent to it. With Jumpluff still around, you would have had the speed advantage against the Sneasler, but instead, Torkoal just comes right back onto the field in the other slot, means that Sneasler is going to get an attack off this turn.
And that's one of the things that this Torkoal has access to on Joe. This set is just so unique to him, where he has Helping Hand. Instead of people trying to facilitate in a, say, slow Trick Room fashion, make Torkoal do the damage, he has Overheat in case, you know, as a literal emergency button, but he has the Helping Hand to boost Hisuian Typhlosion's damage. However, there is no access to Terra Fire this game.
Right, the Terastallization has already been used on the Jumpluff and used in kind of a disastrous way where Jumpluff ended up going down. Porygon's taken one turn of sleep so far, would only have a 1 in 3 chance to wake up this turn. Sneasler, while it can get an attack off, can't threaten Typhlosion very much. We'll have to see what happens, but first it's the Helping Hand.
Yeah, Torkoal lends a Helping Hand to the Hisuian Typhlosion. Close combat from a Sneasler brings Torkoal down to pretty much 50% of its HP. Sneasler is at 1 HP, so it doesn't care about these stat drops, but Poison Touch from the Sneasler is going to activate the poison onto Torkoal, putting it on a timer. Sun Boosted Eruptions from this Hisuian Typhlosion gets 2 KOs.
Who needs Terra Fire when you have the Helping Hand? Porygon 2 down in one hit, not something you see very often, never even gets a chance to wake up. Torkoal, though, now on a timer, takes pretty significant damage from the close combat, and then the Poison Touch on top of that means that Torkoal will be very low.
Garchomp is the switch in here for Andrew. He only has 2 Pokemon remaining. Joe has technically not revealed his 4th Pokemon in this matchup yet. It will be the Garchomp and Incineroar. Those are 2 fire types on Joe's end, and Garchomp loves Quicking Earthquake.
Garchomp would love to get an Earthquake here. Incineroar can also go for a knockoff and a Typhlosion, no Terastallization to get away from that at the moment. Both of them also crucially resist the eruption that Typhlosion is now locked into. Now, they resist it. Helping Hand, Sun Boosted Eruption is still going to do a bunch to them, but Incineroar will take it a little bit better. So you could try to protect Garchomp and get through the turn, or you could just try to look for 2 KOs on this turn. Really a big threat, but actually Garchomp just faster than Typhlosion here. It trained in speed in a way that Typhlosion is not, despite a natural speed advantage for Typhlosion, means that Typhlosion goes down. Critical information for this match.
That's huge to know going into the future games here. That Garchomp one-hit KOs Hisuian Typhlosion with Stomping Tantrum and is faster. Overheat in the Sun, that is ineffective as Garchomp is a dragon type, so it hardly does any damage. And now Torkoal on the clock with Toxic or being poisoned and lowered special attack. It's just King Gambit left against a ground type and a fire type on the other side.
A ground type on a fire type on the other side, and a Sun Boost to that Incineroar Flare Blitz means that damage is big on the other side. Torkoal only has 1 turn of life left with the poison from Poison Touch earlier. Andrew decisively ahead in this game 1.
Yeah, you look, Joe looking at, do I Sucker Punch, do I Low Kick? Turns out he will Helping Hand into this King Gambit, so we'll do more damage if the Sucker Punch goes through. Yes, Garchomp went for an attack. Sucker Punch is not enough to take out the Garchomp. You'll have some Rough Skin damage in retaliation onto the King Gambit, and then a super effective Stomping Tantrum bringing King Gambit down very low. Here's the Sun Boosted Flare Blitz into King Gambit, and that's gonna be it here for game 1. Andrew Zhang, 1 game away from winning his first regional championship.
Andrew just getting absolutely everything here. The speed advantage with Garchomp. The Garchomp being able to take the Sucker Punch and hang on. The damage coming through into King Gambit. Just so far ahead in that game 1. And all of that really traces back to that turn 1 call out to close combat into the Jumpluff. Joe used such a valuable resource in the Terastallization just to have it backfire and lose the Jumpluff, which would have been key to kind of mitigating what Sneasler could do later on in the game, or threatening Sleep Powder into Garchomps, or threatening a switch into a Stomping Tantrum. But once that Pokemon goes down in just one turn, things start to look so much more difficult for Joe.
So if you know, we value the Sleep Powder landing on the Porygon 2 at the cost of losing your Terastallization for the game. And remember, Sneasler has the Focus Sash as we see here in the replay. So it's gonna take at least 2 hits minimum to get rid of that pesky Pokemon. How much do you value Sleep Powder in game 2 compared to saving that Terastallization to boost the damage multipliers on your Hisuian Typhlosion?
It seems like if the strategy is going to be Typhlosion, then the Jumpluff is absolutely critical. And the main reason for that isn't any of the stuff we saw early on. It's the speed advantage for Garchomp against the Typhlosion. If you don't have the Tailwind threat from Jumpluff, or the Sleep Powder threat to stop Garchomp from attacking, then every time Garchomp and Typhlosion are up against each other, it is a disaster for Joe, because there's gonna be a Stomping Tantrum coming that way and a lot of damage that's difficult for him to deal with. the Dragonite would be the only safe switch in. Maybe that's an adjustment you have to make to have some kind of defensive backbone against Stomping Tantrum. But otherwise, you've got to keep Jump Bluff alive, and you have to be ready to get the speed advantage in Typhlosion's favor.
Joe Ugarte's back is against the wall, but this is not the first time he's been down in the finals. He's made many finals at the regional level in his career. Hisuian, Typhlosion, and Torkoal is the lead adjustment for Joe in this game two. Andrew with Incineroar and Porygon 2. Oh, Torkoal actually gets swapped out immediately because of the Incineroar Intimidate lowering its stats, forcing the eject pack to activate.
Torkoal immediately off the field is probably not so bad for Joe. Gets another threat in to do some damage. Could have been the Jump Bluff to have some support alongside this, but right now King Gambit comes in a pretty strong position. Has to worry about a Flare Blitz, but anything that can draw attention away from Typhlosion is pretty good. Meanwhile, Typhlosion isn't in the best position for, we saw what the damage is into Porygon 2, but that was with Helping Hand last time. And if you just get damage into Porygon 2 and Incineroar without getting a KO, then Typhlosion could go down, but calls out the Terrestrialization, it doesn't get it.
He called Typhlosion to Terrestrialize into just a Fire type. So Joe stays with the Ghost type, avoids that fake out, and the low kick into Incineroar. You see Joe nodding along, knowing that was the right play. Now Andrew had the big turn one in game one. Joe gets the knockout in game two.
Really crucial turn. Thought maybe Joe would fish for enough damage to KO the Porygon 2 by using the Fire Terrestrialization, and the fake out would just block it. Instead, fake out does nothing, and Incineroar, a really crucial piece for being able to resist the fire offense, goes down. And now Trick Room went up, hoping to have Incineroar take advantage of it, but it's Sneasler forced onto the field. Will actually be the last thing to move inside of this Trick Room. Porygon 2 will move first. Oh, it's just over.
It's over. It's absolutely over. Andrew, understanding that was GG. Went a little overzealous, going for the fake out into the ghost type. King Gambit was going to Terra Flying as well, so he'd be no longer weak to close combat. But when you set up Trick Room for yourself, and then Sneasler is going to be the slowest Pokemon on the field, with the Focus Sash will get broken, you'll just get the double KO, and the Porygon 2 doesn't threaten enough damage into the King Gambit or the Torkoal.
Just a really poor single turn for Andrew.
I told you it'd be fast, Len.
A very quick reaction to it, too. Surprised not to see that play out. But probably some frustration about how that turn went, making that kind of mistake to fake out the Typhlosion and just quickly moving us on to game three of this finals. Yeah, we talked before the match about how the Trick Room could go either way. It can be a powerful tool if you're up against the right Pokemon, the Garchomp, the Jumpluff, the Typhlosion. But if it is the Torkoal, which we knew was in the back in that situation, the King Gambit that was already on the field for Joe, then that Trick Room is a lot more difficult to use, especially if you've already lost Incineroar. We have to imagine Amoongus not waiting in the back for Andrew. It would have been the thing to hit the field instead of the Sneasler. So just a couple of fast Pokemon that weren't going to be able to take advantage of the Trick Room. You can imagine the game plan was probably Trick Room goes up, King Gambit, or the Incineroar rather, is still around on the field and is then threatening big damage into either the King Gambit or the Hisuian Typhlosion. But with that failed fake out and the eruption damage coming through, it just wasn't the case.
So if you're keeping track at home, game one, Andrew calls the Terra on the flying type, goes for the close combat, making a prediction. But then game two makes the prediction into the ghost type that he's going to Terrestrialize so you can fake out. So it seems like Andrew, we say Joe is the go for broke kind of player. Andrew is matching his energy.
No, Andrew is absolutely matching his energy. And what sometimes it is a very good way to play it. If you know the other player is going to make big calls, well, it takes making risks to make big calls. And then making big calls is a way to exploit the risks that another player has taken. So Joe is going to go for something big, like the Terra Fire Eruption. If you can call that out, then you can win. But if it backfires, it can be just destructive, as it was in game two.
The final game of the weekend, game three of the Louisville Regional Championship Finals. Andrew Zhang and Joe Ugarte. It's Incineroar Porygon 2 yet again to intimidate this Torkoal. Joe is going to swap the Torkoal out. As you mentioned in game two, it's not the end of the world because Torkoal is so slow. He'd take a lot of damage anyway. His job is to set the sun. Now you can potentially have Jumpluff and Hisuian Typhlosion on the field on turn one in the sun.
Right, this is the perfect combination to have. I was surprised to see Joe not go into it when given the opportunity in game two, but this time with Jumpluff already on the field, it is quick and easy. It is much more difficult to get these two next to each other when the a jetpack doesn't do it for you. Now you can have so many different threatened options. You can try to sleep powder the Porygon, you can go for offense. Of course, the Incineroar can still respond with knockoff into Typhlosion or Flare Blitz into Jumpluff. Either one might just be a KO. You can try to call out a Trick Room and get your own Trick Room sweepers out on the field. So it is still a very volatile position, a position that is ready for either of these players to make the kinds of big calls they've shown us they want to make. For now, Jumpluff leaving the field, what's going
to
come in?
And now Andrew has to make the call. Last time he expected Joe to drop the Ghost type beam and click Fake Out. This time, do you expect him to stay a Ghost type and click the knockoff? It will be no terrestrialization from Hisuian Typhlosion. Eruption in the Sun brings Porygon down very low, but Incineroar will go for the Flare Blitz into the Torkoal switch in there, doing resisted damage. Now it's up to the Porygon 2 to click Trick Room, and Torkoal is the fastest Pokemon under the Twisted Dimensions.
Torkoal should be the fastest thing and threatening a ton of damage of its own. No eruption from the Torkoal this sign because there's no Trick Room from Joe. He doesn't usually expect to be in this position, but still threatening a lot of damage. Andrew decides after how game two went, don't try to opt into guessing what the Typhlosion is going to do. Just try to get a Flare Blitz and KO the Jumpluff. It was very strong for him in game one when Jumpluff went down early, but Joe doesn't allow it to happen. Gets Jumpluff safely into the back and instead has the Torkoal take that Flare Blitz. Now it is time to fire Terastalize that Typhlosion. The offense is ready to go.
Yeah, these attacks will be so massive from Joe in the Sun. Overheat does land into Porygon for the KO. So Andrew's patented Pokemon that's helped get him so far in this tournament. We've seen how crucial Porygon 2 has been in his two stream sets in top 8 and top 4. But the knockoff into now just the fire type on Hisuian Typhlosion means it doesn't get the KO. There's no choice specs, but you're still Terrifier and the eruption. Incineroar is going to resist that though, so it does not get a KO.
Right, you use the fire terastalization to be able to take the knockoff, but the knockoff still mitigates so much of the damage because Typhlosion was still forced to use eruption on that turn, and so used it from only about 40% health and lost the 1.5 boost from the choice mech. So even with a single target, eruption isn't able to do a super significant damage to Incineroar. Definitely not enough damage that the -2 Torkoal is threatening a KO into the Incineroar, so pretty safe. The Amoongus also now hits the field in Trick Room. Andrew has all of the tools to try to take advantage of the Trick Room and ended his game two in this game three. Joe's going to have to find the right response to it. Step one of that is going to be probably figuring out where the Spore is coming. If he can land the Jumpluff into a Spore, that's progress in coming back into this game. But if a Pokemon ends up asleep out of this and Incineroar gets a big attack off or just parting shots its way to come back in later, or for now just a Pollen Puff to get healthy again, all of them are problems for Joe.
Amoongus moving first under Trick Room here. Torkoal is -2, but he goes into the Incineroar that just healed 50% from Amoongus's Pollen Puff, so it did no damage there. Now you have Flare Blitz from Incineroar into Typhlosion, resisted, and it doesn't matter. Typhlosion is down.
A strong turn for Andrew. Joe wants to just finish something off, use the Torkoal to try to get this Incineroar off the field. But Andrew doesn't fall for it, doesn't try to guess where the Jumpluff might be coming, doesn't try to get a Spore, instead just Pollen Puffs this Incineroar, and this Incineroar is looking like a massive problem for Joe. The Sun boost to Flare Blitz means that he can use it really aggressively offensively. The King Gambit has an Assault Vest, can't protect itself. Both Pokemon that could be in that slot are weak to fire. The Amoongus can move first and heal the Incineroar even more. Not often that we see Incineroar as a really potent offensive threat, but it's shaping up to be one in this game. Of course, King Gambit can also, we saw the low kick damage from King Gambit in the previous game. It also might move before Incineroar in this Tailwind, so the Trick Room. So the other option is just Rage Powder away those attacks. Torkoal now at -4, still a damage threat into Amoongus, but probably not a one-hit KO threat. So really, it seems like all the momentum, all the options are on Andrew's side. Joe's going to have to make one of those kinds of big plays that he's famous for to fight his way back into this game.
And the King Gambit is in a really tough spot as you've already used the terrestrialization on Typhlosion. That means he cannot get out of this fire weakness. Sucker Punch goes into Incineroar, doesn't do a lot. The Spore from Amoongus will put King Gambit to sleep. That means that King Gambit will be forced to take that first turn of sleep the following turn. Here is a -4 overheat into the Incineroar. I think two turns in a row, Joe potentially expecting or hoping for a switch into that slot, but King Gambit is just dead. Incineroar claims another KO.
both the Spore and the Flare Blitz go into that slot, but the damage was enough that recoil is going to take down this Incineroar. This Incineroar that has been such a problem for Joe is gone, but things look so difficult that his Torkoal at -6 and cannot switch. It is stuck on the field. Sun will expire soon. Trick Room will expire soon, and things will flip to a speed advantage for Andrew. Now, the Jump Puff was the most important, maybe the most important piece of this for Joe from the beginning. It's still around, but it's not important as a damage threat. That's really the problem for Joe here. The minus Circus Torkoal is not the damage answer. The Jump Puff is not the damage answer, and if it tries to be the damage answer, it will quickly find itself at -6 as well.
It's finally time for Andrew to respond with his Terrastalization here in game three. Will be Terra Fire for Garchomp. I'm sure Andrew's found many uses of it throughout the tournament this weekend, probably avoiding Will-O-Wisp and things of that nature. But this time it will just resist a lot of these attacks. The Spore from Amoongus will put Torkoal to sleep. Not that Torkoal would have been much of a damage threat at this point at -6 special attack. Torkoal taking that first turn of sleep. Here's the Dragon Claw into Jump Bluff. That is a two-hit KO. Sleep Powder does land into the Garchomp, so that means Garchomp cannot attack next turn.
Everything is napping for the moment, but the damage recipe is just so difficult for Joe. Trick Room and Sun both expire on this turn. Amoongus will move last at the end of this turn, but is even less threatened by Overheat from Torkoal now without the amplification from Sun damage. Encore is going to keep Amoongus using Spore, but it's just a matter of time for this Garchomp to wake up. Where is the damage against the Garchomp?
Garchomp's going to be asleep here now as a fire type. It both resists Overheat, it resists the grass attacks from the Jump Bluff. There is no Sun anymore to boost your Overheat damage either. You can Encore Amoongus into the Spore. That's not going to work in the Jump Bluff, and Torkoal is already asleep. But you know, at a certain point, as you're saying, Len, the Garchomp doesn't care if it's three turns asleep or six turns asleep. He's not taking any valuable damage.
Right, even if you start to get Leaf Storm damage like this first one, it can just be Pollen Puff back off. And look how small that is. That is the strongest a Leaf Storm will ever be in this game. Andrew is just so far ahead. Garchomp now wakes up. It's going to get the Dragon Claw off. That's the end of Jump Bluff. This game is all but over.
Yeah, Torkoal is Joe's final soldier standing. One of his patented Pokemon that everybody knows him for. Joe has definitely had much success in his career with the Sun Core. Won a regional back in 2019 with Sun. Won in 2023 with Sun. And here we'll finish second. He's going to lock in the forfeit. And Andrew Zhang will win his first ever regional championship in the Masters Division here in Louisville. What a phenomenal performance this weekend for Andrew.
Just so well played throughout this top cut, taking down difficult opponents from Wolf to Joe. Parker's interesting new matchup for Andrew to fight. Every step of the way, it felt like Andrew was in control, knew his gameplay, knew his path, especially felt like he was in control of the speeds so often, always making opponents second guess where they were in the speed control and really using that in his advantage.